This conference will now be recorded. This conference will now be recorded.
Good evening. Today's class is credit risk measurement and management. We are going to the structured credit risk. Most of the concepts will be theoretical. Let us go through the aim statement. After completing this reading, we should be able to describe what are the common types of structured products, and we should be able to describe the tranching and the distribution of credit losses in a securitization. We should be able to describe the waterfall structure in a securitization, identify the key participants in the securitization process, evaluate one or two iterations of interim cash flows in a three-tiered securitization structure, describe a simulation approach for calculating credit losses for different tranches in a securitization, explain how the default probabilities and default correlations affect the credit risk in a securitization. Here we should have a strong conceptual understanding about how the default probabilities and default correlations, and it will be mostly tested by COB. We should also know to explain how the default sensitivities for all tranches are measured, what are the risk factors that impact structured products, and finally define the implied correlation and describe how it can be measured. And we should also know the motivations for using structured credit products. So let us begin the topic. Let us find out what are the two important innovations in recent memory. By asking that questions, let me start this session. There are two types of important innovation in recent memories. One is securitization process, and number two will be the structured products, which came as a part of the securitization process. So the securitization process was the first important innovation. Then comes the structured products as a result of securitization process. Let us see what is securitization. Securitization is nothing but a pooling of credit sensitive assets, and it's a creation of new securities, which is called a structured products. So let us see what is structured products. Structured products are nothing but the cash in this structured products. The cash flows are based on the underlying claims. Each product has its own risk and return characteristics. It varies in maturity, subordination, what are the types of collateral. That we are going to see in detail, what are the type of subordination, what varies in maturity. For example, it can be mortgages, auto loans, and credit card loans. So these are the structured products whereby various assets are pooled, and we do the process of securitization, and we create new securities, which is called as structured products. Then what is the true test of securitization? This is an important concept. We should know what is the true test of securitization. The true test is securitization removes the assets completely from the balance sheet. So whether to test whether it is securitization or not, we should know whether the assets are completely removed from the balance sheet. Again, a question will come to you, from whose balance sheet it is removed. It is the originator's balance sheet, the person who is originating the securitization process. And generally, securitization will shrink the economic balance sheet. Both assets will come down and liabilities also will come down. That we are going to see in detail in the coming slides. Another test is whether there is a true sale. True sale is complete delinking from the originator and a special purpose vehicle. So legally, they want to make a separate wall. And only when it is a true sale, it will become bankruptcy remote, and none of the impact of creditworthiness of the originator will affect the special purpose vehicle. So these are the two tests which we have to keep in mind. So we are going to see the motivations in detail, but before that, what are the motivations of securitization in general? Is we want to improve the rating or decrease the leverage, increasing the borrowing capacity of the originator or tax and accounting purposes. So suppose for example, there is a company and it wants to start a project. So the A company's rating is triple B, but it wants to start a new project. It doesn't have enough borrowing capacity. So what happens? It sells some of its assets in the balance sheet to a special purpose vehicle, and it provides some credit enhancements, whereby the special purpose vehicle rating can be AAA. So this enables the A company, the originator company, to decrease its leverage. Leverage is nothing, as you know. Leverage, if you ask me what is leverage, suppose I am having a capital of 100 and I am doing I am acquiring 1,000 worth of assets and doing a lot of business. And again, with the same capital, I am doing 2,000 asset size business. That is called as I am increasing my leverage and I am borrowing more from the market and putting in my business while keeping my capital the same level. That's increasing the leverage. So the same way, securitization enables the originator to sell his assets, to reduce his balance sheet so that he can borrow more and increase his leverage. So at any point of time, you can interrupt me, and any doubt is there, you can ask me also. Let us go to the next slide. What are the describe the common types of structured products. Structured credit products, like other structured products, is a pool of assets backed by risky debt instruments. As I told you earlier, it's just a pool of assets. The difference is that structured credit products create tranches that have different amounts of credit risk. For example, senior, mezzanine, junior. There will be different credit tranches. The most junior tranches bear the first loss. So any credit loss happens to the pool. The first loss is bad are borne by the equity tranche and is most likely to be written down from the defaulted assets. Once the equity tranche is completely wiped out, again, further credit losses happens. Let us assume that further credit losses happens. The next impact will be taken by the junior tranche. So naturally, the most senior tranche will have the highest credit rating and the lowest probability of write-downs. So let us see what are the common types of structured products broadly. There are four types: covered bonds, mortgage pass-through securities, collateralized mortgage obligation CMO, asset-backed securities MBS CDO. Let us look into each product in detail in the coming slides. What are covered bonds? Covered bonds are nothing but on-balance sheet securitization. Actually, in true sense, it is not a securitization at all, because it is a pool of mortgages which secure a bond issue is separated from the other loans into a covered pool on the originator's balance sheet. Still, it is appearing in the balance sheet. It is on balance sheet securitization. Investors have high priority than general creditors if a bank defaults. Principal and interest is paid and guaranteed by the originator and is not based on the performance of the underlying asset themselves. See here, the risk is not transferred. Since it is on the on-balance sheet, it is the risk lies still with the originator in the case of covered bonds. Thus, covered bonds are not true securitization, since the assets are not part of a bankruptcy remote structure and the investors have recourse against the originator in case of any defaults. So again, what is a bankruptcy remote structure? What do you mean by bankruptcy remote structure? Can you try? What do you mean by bankruptcy remote structure? Bankruptcy remote structure is nothing, but it builds a wall between the general creditors. For example, the assets of the securitization will not became a part of the general creditors pooling list in the case of bankruptcy. That's a simple definition. So, for example, in the case of single purpose SPV or a single purpose entity, it has little impact on other entities within the group. So that is the purpose of the true securitization. Here, the investors have high priority than general creditors if a bank defaults. So thus, covered bonds are not true securitizations. The assets are not part of the bankruptcy remorse structure, and the investors have recourse against the originator. In the case of off-balance sheet securitization, investors will not have recourse against the originator. The originator will be separate. That's the main concept we have to understand. So describe the common types of structured mortgage pass-through securities. In contrast to mortgage pass-through securities are nothing but they are true off-balance sheet securitization. In this securitization, the entire cash flows are based on the performance of the pool. It is not guaranteed by the originator in the case of previous covered bonds. In this case, it is based on the performance of the pool less the associated fees paid to the servicer. Most pass-throughs are agency mortgage-backed securities that carry implicit or explicit government guarantee of performance. So in the case of pass-through mortgage-backed securities, default risk is not a serious concern because it is guaranteed by the government. What is the primary risk in the mortgage pass-through securities? Let me repeat. What is the primary risk in mortgage pass-through securities? There is no risk of default risk is not there. Then what will be the primary risk? The primary risk will be mostly the reinvestment risk. For example, there will be a lot, if there is a prepayment. The mortgage pass-through securities are more susceptible to prepayment, and as a result of reinvestment risk will be more in the case of mortgage pass-through securities. So the primary risk is due to prepayment of principal by the homeowner. For example, in the case of housing loan securitization, subprime products, most likely from refinancing after the interest rate declines or home sales. What do you mean by that? For example, recently in India also, the RBI has cut the repo rate, and newspaper, all news flashed that banks are going to cut its home loan rates. Suppose a borrower may look to other banks and see that interest rates is declining. He may take loan from other bank and pre-close the one with the existing bank. The same way, In the same way, the mortgager, the borrower also will be able to prepay the loan, as his payment will be more, his income will be more, whereas his interest burden has come down. So most likely from refinancing after the interest rate declines of home loan sales. So when you are asked that what is the primary risk in mortgage pass-through securities, the answer should be the primary risk is due to prepayment of principal by the homeowner. Prepayment risk. And what is collateralized mortgage obligations? In the case of collateralized mortgage obligations, the loans amortize over time, creating cash flows that diminish over time. So it is a self-liquidating securities. CMOs are sliced or tranched into bonds or tranches that are paid down on a specified schedule. CMOs were developed to create bonds for investors who want exposure to mortgages but with less prepayment risk. So it's an improvement over the previous product. They want exposure to mortgages but with less prepayment risk, and also as a way to create both longer and shorter term bonds out of a single pool. So the simplest CMO structure is sequential pay, in which the tranches are ordered with class A receiving all principal payments from the loan until it is retired, then class B and so on. So in this case, For example, if you are asked which tranche have less prepayment risk than the pass-through securities, there are some spelling mistakes here. Securities, which tranche have less prepayment risk than a pass-through securities? So the higher tranches in the sequence will have less prepayment risk than the pass-through, while the lower ones bear more. So in this case, the lower tranches bear more prepayment risk. What are the common types of structured products? This is the most general class of securitization where cash, how generating assets are pooled and subsequently tranched. Under this definition, ABS is a special case of the more general ABS. Other varieties include collateralized bond obligations, collateralized debt obligations, collateralized loan obligations, and collateralized mortgage obligations, etc. So even concept, there are more complex securities that pull other than securities together with the CDO squared, CDOs of CDOs. These are all more complex structures. So after seeing all the structured products, if you are asked a question, the recent US subprime crisis was a nationwide crisis in the year 2007 to 2010, whereby a housing bubble was created. What type of variants of securities led to the subprime crisis? So my question is, what type of variants of securities led to the subprime crisis? Especially my question is confined to the structured products. You can think for a minute. Let us see the answer. So mortgage-backed securities and collateralized debt obligations. So the two major securities which played an important role in this housing bubble that led to the nationwide, global-wide crisis, we can say, the year 2007-2010. So again, another question, what are the dimensions in credit structured products? There are three dimensions, basically. The first dimension we should understand is what is the nature of underlying. So what is the securities I am holding in the pool? What are the type of assets I am holding in the pool? What is its nature? The dimension two is what is the size and number of tranches in the pool? And now dimension number three is the most important one, whether the structured assets are passively or actively managed. So what do you mean by passively managing? And what do you mean by actively managing? Passive pool is not much action is there. For example, we have mortgages and auto loans which gets repaid over a period of time and till the life of the loan. But actively managed, we'll add or shed loans from time to time. They may add or shed loan and from time to time. For example, we can say credit card also, main payments. Then what do you mean by revolving pool? This is an important concept which we should understand. What do you mean by revolving pool? We know about passive pool, actively managed pool. And in this case, what do you mean by revolving pool? This has a time period where loan repayment proceeds are reinvestment in new assets. Example, credit cards. So revolving pool is nothing but their loan repayment proceeds once received by the pool are reinvested in new assets. Again and again, it goes on till the life of the pool. In the case of actively managed pool, the asset manager will look for overvalued, undervalued loans based on the default happening. This is predicted. Suppose the default probability of a pool of bond is more than the default probability expected, and the value will come down, he will sell it, and vice versa, he will buy undervalued bonds. So he will shed and add or shed loans based on the worthiness of the loans from time to time. So it is actively managed. Describe branching and the distribution of credit losses in a securitization. So this is a pictorial representation of securitization waterfall structure. Here we can see the senior tranche in the top, mezzanine tranche in the middle, and the equity tranche in the bottom. The senior tranche is naturally the safest and it gets the highest priority in cash flow. So whenever cash flows are received in the pool, the first tranche which is getting the benefit will be the senior tranche. Naturally, since it is safe as a part of the risk reward structure, it has the lowest coupon. This coupon will be naturally low, but it will be the largest size in the structure. This will have the largest size in the structure. Whereas in the case of mezzanine, or we can call it a junior tranche, there will be moderate risk because this tranche will start absorbing losses after the equity is wiped off. So there is always a moderate risk and it gets the second highest priority in cash flow. After the senior tranche is paid out, then the mezzanine tranche gets the payment. So naturally, because of this moderate risk, its coupon are very high. In the case of fixed, it has highest coupon. In the case of floating, it has the highest spread. So your another important point is, see, in the case of senior tranche, the size is large. But in the case of mezzanine tranche, the size is kept small. Why? Because to keep the structure viable, if it is more, the cost of the expenses in the pool will be more. So the size of the mezzanine will be kept small, intentionally small, to keep the structure viable. The bottom tranche is the equity tranche. It has the highest risk in the structure. And it's the first loss piece. Any default happens in the pool after exhausting the excess spread, over collateralization, everything, the loss is borne by the equity tranche. So after making all the payments to senior and mezzanine, the payments are not sufficient, then equity tranche has to bear the loss. So it will be the smallest part, thinnest tranche, smallest part of the structure. And it has the last priority in cash flow, receiving all surplus residuals, and it has no coupon. So let us describe tranching and the distribution of credit losses in a securitization. So we have seen what do you mean by tranching, and we have saw the distribution of credit losses in a securitization. This is a theoretical write-up to have a revision. Senior bonds are typical, whatever I told, it is just a revision to place emphasis so that it will be in your mind. Senior bonds are typically the bulk of the liabilities in a securitization. But if the underlying collateral cannot be financed primarily by a low yielding senior debt, a securitization is generally not viable. Because only the senior debt should be the maximum, then only the average cost of the pool will come down and it will improve the return to the equity holders. So equity holders will not invest in the pool unless they are getting unless there is a probability of getting a good return. So more weightage to senior bonds brings down the average cost of interest expense. So this capital structure is sometimes also called as the capital stock, with senior bonds at the top of the stack. These are all technical terms which we have to remember. Most securitization also features securitization with different maturities but the same seniority. So it's a combination of duration. For investors who want different durations of pools can opt for the securitization. So they want this product to be available to all investors who wants different duration of the products according to their cash flows or liquidity mismatches. So there's a desire of different investors for bonds with different durations. Some may want 1 year, 2 year, 5 year, 10 year. So it depends on their need of funds. This is structured. Again, describe the waterfall structure in securitization. Just we will now look revise once again based on the cash flows. So it's a top-down approach. Senior tranche has the highest priority in cash flow. Maslin Tranche has the second highest priority in cash flow. The last priority in cash flow receives all surplus residual finally. It doesn't have any coupon. But the important point here to note is this cash flow structure. In the case of intermittent cash flows, if there's an agreement, it will goes to trust us for the agreement. It goes to a separate trust account, whereby it will be used for future shortfall before the maturity of the pool. So whenever the question, GARP asks some questions to test your knowledge, sometimes they may give this clause also where the intermittent cash flows may go to the trust which may be used, which has to be taken into account while solving the problems. So again, this is, as I already explained, this is theoretical explanation. We'll go through it. The waterfall refers to the rules about how the cash flows from the collateral are distributed to the various securities in the capital structure. The term waterfall is used because the capital structure is paid in a top-down sequence, the senior debt receiving all of its promised payments before any lower tranche receives any monies. In addition to the coupons and other payments promised to the bank bonds, there are fees and other costs to be paid, which typically takes priority over coupons. So, one more important point here is before paying the tranche holders, if there are fees and other costs to be paid, it has to be paid before paying the coupons on the pools. So, let us come to the next topic, the credit protection to the tranches. There are two types of credit enhancement. One is internal credit enhancement, another one is external credit enhancement. Let us look into the internal credit enhancement. External credit enhancement is nothing but guarantees or buying a CDs or it is sort of from an external vendor. That is all the external guarantees or by the originator. Internal credit enhancement, there are two types of internal credit enhancement. One is over collateralization. So all called as hard credit enhancements. The example I can give is, suppose there's a pool and it has 100 face value of MBS and the collateral given by the originator transferred to the pool is 102 mortgages. So there are two surplus collateral and the pool can withstand a shock of two defaults till it affects the pool. So this is an example of over collateralization. These are normally called as hard credit enhancements. Next one is excess spread. So intentionally, the loan yield will be higher than the cost of the pool. This is called as the excess spread. These are called as soft credit enhancements. So we should know the difference between the soft and hard credit enhancements, and the both is enhancement. GARPs will be, the GARP will be mostly testing in these areas. So let us see an example of excess spread. Assume a collateralized loan obligation in which underlying assets consist of 100 identical leveraged loans with a par value of $1 million each. The loans are priced at par. So 100 million. With the value of the assets and the loans are priced at par. The originator is going to transfer these funds to the SPV. Loans are floating rate obligations that pay the fixed spread of 3.5% over the 1 month LIBOR. So let us assume away the upfront fee management, there are no trust fees. And the capital structure consists of equity, junior, senior bond. The mezzanine attachment point is 5%. The senior attachment point is 15%. See here, the attachment point we should understand is the mezzanine point attaches the equity from above and the senior tranche from below. So nothing but is the width of the band. Assuming there are no defaults and we assume the swap curve LIBOR is flat at 5%, the excess spread is equal to. But let us see the example, how it is worked out. You have seen the collateral is 100. L plus 3.5. Here LIBOR is 5%. The LIBOR is 5%. You can see the LIBOR is 5%. And the collateral is 100. 5 plus 3.5 is 8.5%. So we are receiving a interest of 8.5 million from this collateral of assets. And the senior is, as I said, the attachment point is 15%. So it is 85. And the mezzanine is 10%. It is 10. So 85 into 5 plus 0.5, 5.5% is $4.675. Here 5 plus 5 is 10. Remember, the mezzanine is having the highest interest rate, whereas the senior is having a lower interest rate. CL 5.5, here 10%, because of the risk reward structure. Because mezzanine bears the highest risk, where senior tranche is more safe and normally rated as higher rating of AAA, like that. So $10 into 10% is equal to $1. So this 8.5 minus 5.675, 4 plus 1, these are the payments that we are going to make to the tranche holders. So the 8.5 is the one which we receive from the collateral. And excess, this can be termed as an excess spread of $2.825 million. So it's nothing but the difference between the cash flows collected and the payments made to all bond holders. And another point to remember is excess spread will be always zero at origination. Excess spread is invested and made available for future shortfalls, and it is given to a separate trust account if the agreement provides so. So excess spread is also invested and made available for future shortfalls to a separate trust account. This is called as soft credit enhancement. As I told earlier, it's called a soft credit enhancement. So what are the complexities in waterfall structure? The complexities when you are trying to compute various default sensitivities, implied correlation, what will be the credit war, some complexities come in the waterfall structure. But as a forum level 2 student, you are expected to have a thorough understanding in this portion, this theoretical portion. Initially, the underlying cash flows will be the largest in initial years. So the trust will build up against a reserve against future shortfall. So it might be uniform till the end of the period. Sometimes the underlying cash flows will be highest in the initial year and slowly declining based on the default occurrences and recovery of the defaults. So what we saw in so far is a three triad structure, but here in practice, securitization have a more than dozen or more tranches. It has different coupons, different maturities, different over-collateralization triggers. And number two is, equity investors will invest in the pool based on certain loan defaults, expecting they will get some return. But normally, the loan defaults will change. It may be more or less than expected. The defaults are less than expected, then equity shareholders, equity holders will gain more, otherwise they will lose the money. So the major takeaways which we should remember is, senior tranche is the safest, has the lowest coupon but the largest size. Mezzanine is the moderate risk, high coupon, thin size. Equity is the highest risk, residual cash flows and thinnest size. So if a GARP asks you which is the thinnest size in a three-tier structure, the answer should be equity. These are the three main differences that you have to remember as we proceed into the chapter. Let us go into a question, practical questions. Find out the cash flows to mezzanine and excess trust account in the first year. So in this case, the question has stipulated the payment to trust account. And they have asked not the terminal cash flows, but what is the cash flows in the first year. Assuming there are 100 identical loans with a principal balance of rupees dollar 5 lakh each, based on the credit analysis, 300 basis point spread is applied to the borrowers. So LIBOR is at 4% with annual reset. Annual reset means the interest rate is set on reset based on the market condition annually. And here we, for simplicity's sake, we assume the default rate is constant across the maturities at 2%. So the attachment points are given here. The senior is 75%, mezzanine is 20%, equity is 5%. Spreads are 2% for senior, 6% for mezzanine. So the question what is asked is, we have to find out the cash flows to the mezzanine and excess trust account in the first year. Can you try? Let us see the workings. Let us see here, the loan interest rate is equal to LIBOR plus spread, which they are given LIBOR as 4% and spread is 3%, is equal to 7%. Survival rate is nothing but 1 minus default rate, is a survival rate. So here 1 minus 2% is equal to 98%. So these are the workings that are required for computing the cash flows to the mezzanine. The total cash flows from the collateral is 100 into 5 lakh into 7% into 19% is 343,000. So here number of loans into face value into rate of interest into survival rate. This is the total cash flows from the collateral which we are going to receive. So that's why shown in green. So this 100 face value into 5 lakh into 7% is the rate of interest which you have arrived here. Into the 98% after the default, which is the surviving loans only pay me the cash flows. So it comes to $343,000. So let us compute a senior tranche. How much we have to pay to the senior tranche fellow? When you received as asset manager, you got this much amount. How much you have to pay to the senior tranche? Here the rate of interest is already given in the sum as LIBOR is 4%. The spread they are given is 2%. So 4 plus 2 is equal to 6%. The tranche percentage into pool size into rate of interest is 75% into 100. So you see the attachment point is 75%. So 75% into 100 into 5 lakh into 6%. So on the 6% interest, there will be 22,50,000 which has to be paid off to the senior tranche. So we will check. This is the interest has to be paid, whether the cash inflows and outflows to be paid are more, which is higher. This is higher. So we can easily pay off this fellow, senior tranche, we can pay him off. Then comes the next priority to mezzanine tranche. The promised rate of return is LIBOR plus spread. 4% plus 6% is 10%. Again, senior tranche rate of interest is low. Here mezzanine tranche rate of interest is high. Because of the inherent risk involved. Here the tranche percentage into pool size into rate of interest. The attachment point is here, 20% into 100 into 5 lakh into 10% the rate of interest. So we have to pay 10 lakhs. So again, we see whether both together and whichever is bigger. In 343, 34,30,000 is bigger than both these obligations. So we pay mezzanine tranche also. So first year we'll pay this much amount to him. Answer will be first year you'll pay to the mezzanine tranche this much amount. Then the equity tranche, 5% into 100 into the attachment point is 5% and pool size into 100 into 5 lakh is equal to 10 lakhs. So what are the residual cash flows? Here it is not enough. See, this dollar 34,30,000 is not enough. After paying this, I have only 1,80,000 $1 left. So this is the final year. I will pay to the equity shareholders and no cash flows to the trust account. Otherwise, stipulated cash flows will go to the trust account, then only the remaining will go to equity shareholders if it is an intermittent structure. So in the question they have asked, what is the final cash outflow? Here we have to say, for equity, we'll receive only 1,80,000 and no cash flows to the trust account because there's no cash completely paid to the equity. So while studying the cash flows, interim and final, what are the important points that you have to remember? And Gaurav is testing you in this area. And a question is asked in this area. When you study the cash flows and you're arriving at the payment made to different tranche holders, first you have to study the inflows prior to the maturity and the terminal cash flows in the final year. So there are two parts. What are the inflows that happen prior to maturity of the pool and the terminal cash flows in the final year? So accordingly, a strategy we have to devise. If it is inflows prior to maturity, interest on the collateral plus recovery rate from the sale of any defaulted assets during the current period, you have to take into account for distribution. Again, I am repeating, if the inflows are calculated prior to the maturity and has to be distributed prior to the maturity of the pool, interest on the collateral received plus the recovery rate from the sale of any defaulted assets during the current period has to be used. Suppose this is the final year. The terminal cash flows in the final year, we should use that. Remember, if it is the terminal cash flows that you are going to calculate the final year of the pool at the end of the life of the pool, the last interest payment plus principal plus recovery of the defaulted assets plus interest earned and recovered funds from defaults over the remaining period of pool life. Also, please remember, in the final year, there will be no diversion to trust accounts. So if it is the last year, interest payment plus principal plus recovery of defaulted assets plus interest earned and recovered assets from defaults over the remaining period of pool life. These are the two important points we have to remember. So let us again see what are the terminal cash flows and overview. Terminal cash flows has the following components: loan interest, proceeds from redemption of surviving loans, recovery in the final year, and interest, if any, in the recovered assets and residual balance in the trust account. These are the four components which has to be added while distribution. So let us identify the key participants in the securitization process. Who are the key participants in the securitization process? Let us study the participants, major key only, not all. There are a lot of participants in the securitization process. Only we are going to study the key participants, and a detailed study will be done at a later stage. First one is originator, who funds the loan, and he also known as sponsor. The originator may be a banker or lender, or a financial intermediary. We normally use the term sponsor if most of the collateral is supplied by him. Is supplied by the originator. If the originator gives most of the collateral, then we call them a sponsor. First, let us see the role, then we'll come to the conflict of interest. Who is an underwriter? The second participant will be underwriter or arranger of the structures of the issue. He structures the issue and or he sells the bonds to the investors. So underwriter is a person who takes over the collateral, he structures the issue, sells the bond to the investors. And he also warehouses the collateral and faces risk of non-marketing the collateral or the value of collateral dropping. Here the spelling mistake is there. He warehouses the collateral and faces risk of non-marketing of the bonds. So Suppose he is the one who sells the bonds to the investor, he has the risk of non-marketing the bonds and value of collateral dropping in between. Credit rating agencies. What is the role of credit rating agencies in the securitization? Third role. He assesses the credit riskiness of the securitization process. Without the credit rating agencies, the investors do not have the technical expertise to appraise the credit risk involved in the pool of investments. Normally, credit rating agencies influence the size of tranche by demanding more the desired attachment point and more credit enhancements. So they indulge in a dialogue with the arranger, asking for a thickness of the mezzanine tranche or equity tranche for giving a good rating to the senior bonds. He will also demand the size of tranche and will ask for more credit enhancements to give a desired rating demanded by the arranger. The fourth one is servicer who collects and distributions of collateral cash flows. So servicer's role is collection and distribution of collateral cash flows, and he provides liquidity in case of delayed payments. So the four major key participants. Let us see what are the conflict of interest. In the case of originator, there is a conflict of interest between mortgager, the borrower, arranger, mortgager vis-a-vis originator, and arranger vis-a-vis originator. So in the case of conflict of interest between mortgager vis-a-vis originator, it's a predatory lending to the borrower. The borrower, normally the originator will have an information advantage, and he will not see whether it suits the borrower credit profile or not. He will be just lending although he is not capable. So there will be a just predatory lending. Nobody will be receiving a lot of emails from the emails, personal loan sanctioned, automatic sanction is done, and we are getting phone calls. We'll give you 10 lakhs loans if you say yes online. So they don't do a due diligence, but based on some credit score something, they just try to lend to us. So it's a predatory lending, whether this fellow has enough cash flows to repay and all is not seen. So this is we call it as a predatory lending to the borrower. Also in the case of arranger vis-a-vis originator. So arranger takes the collateral, everything in a good faith from the originator. But originator has a superior knowledge than the arranger about what he is giving to the arranger. So there may be a risk of adverse selection in these cases. In the second role, underwriter vis-a-vis third parties, or arranger vis-a-vis third parties. So here the conflict of interest is mainly like rating agencies, asset managers, and warehouse lenders. Here also this adverse selection problem will be there, because arranger will normally be in a rush to accept whatever the originator gives, and rating agency will not have sufficient information. Correct transparency will not be there to assess the exact risk in the collateral. Same in the case of warehouse lenders also. So in the case of credit rating agencies, the conflict of interest is between investors vis-a-vis credit rating agencies. First of all, they are not hired by investors. They are paid by the originators or arrangers. Normally, the credit rating agencies would like to generate more profits, and this may lead to a compromise of accepting lower size tranches for mezzanine and equity, and larger size for senior tranche, which may affect the investors badly. The fourth conflict is between the servicer with the vis-a-vis investor. So here, the servicer normally delays foreclosure to increase fees. So the more delay is there in foreclosure, he'll be receiving more fees. But investors require quick resolution. He wants to sell the house immediately, And even the house owners also, they want to quickly dispose the house and pay off the liability. So services, reserves, mortgages is also another conflict of interest that we will study in detail. So here the important point that will be tested by the GOB is what are the key frictions that led to the subprime crisis? Some questions may be based on that. What are the key frictions? There are a lot of frictions, six or seven frictions are there, or nine, up to nine frictions are laid down. But what are the key frictions we have to remember which led to the subprime crisis? The first friction is between the mortgagor and the originator. Because the originator has complex products and the mortgagor never understands the nature of the complex products. He may sell it, we'll bundle and sell it to him. Then the second conflict of interest is between the asset manager and investors. Normally, the investors has the greed for additional yield. They will not look into the risk. They will not apply due diligence. Asset manager also will not apply due diligence of what will be the exact risk. And investors will have no clue about it. So there will be a conflict of interest between the asset manager and investors. Again, the third conflict is between the arranger and third parties. Here, the low due diligence. So arranger himself will get a lower information about his product, which will be passed on to the third parties like rating agencies, warehousing. And naturally, the quality of due diligence will be low. So lemons are sold. So here, originator and arranger. Here is the adverse selection problem. The originator has superior information about his collateral, what he's giving, but arranger doesn't have much information about the collateral and he's in a hurry to market it. And normally originator will retain the best ones with him and gives the worst one to the arranger. So when the originator securitizes, he normally packages bad loans or loans considered doubtful to the originator, arranger, who will accept it, who will not know the knowledge, who will not have a knowledge about the collateral he is receiving. So there's a problem of adverse selection in the case of originator and arranger. And finally, fifth key fictions are investors and credit rating agencies. So investors and credit rating agencies, had also received low information. They don't have much knowledge about the collateral. Number two, whatever models they used were naive, were old, outdated models. And they used the same model which they used for corporate, for rating the subprime products. And you know, and they were hopelessly misguided. Investors were hopelessly misguided because of this rating. They thought top rating and it will never default. And since they are getting high yield, everybody rushed to buy in the subprime products. So my question is, do you know approximately what percentage of subprime mortgages were securitized in the year of 2005 and 2006? Just to understand the impact on the global crisis, what level of subprime mortgages were securitized in 2005 and 2006? Statistics says approximately 75% of the subprime mortgages were securitized in the year 2005 and 2006. So when it became a bubble, it was hard to control, and the government has, the Fed has to come into play to bail out many financial institutions. Describe a simulation approach for calculating credit losses for different tranches in a securitization. So now we're coming to the next part. How we can calculate credit losses for different tranches in a securitization. The broad guidelines is, first, we have to estimate the valuation parameters. So how to value the each tranche and how to value the parameters required to value each tranche and generate the default time simulations. Finally, the credit losses. These are the three important points involved in calculating credit losses for different tranches in securitization. So evaluation parameters involve default probability, correlation, and default time simulation is done to what would have been the impact on equity tranche, various tranche depending on the default, and what will be the resultant credit losses. Actually, the technical details are beyond the scope of the exam. However, for familiarity sake, it is better for academic reasons. We may touch it upon. Let us read through this. As I told earlier, the valuation parameters are the default probabilities or default distributions of each individual securities and the correlation used pairwise correlations. So here we use pairwise correlation used to tie individual default distributions together. So these are the parameters we use. Normally, we assume that the default probabilities are constant for simplicity's sake. Then number two is generate default time simulations. Using the estimated parameters and the coupler approach, we simulate the default times of each security. Each security is nothing but the underlying loans in the collateral pool. With the default times in hand, we can next identify for each simulation thread and each security whether it defaults within the life of the securitization and so in what period. So it's a simulation study based on assumptions, whether it defaults within the life of the securities and so in what period and what will be the impact on the credit losses. The default times can be used to generate a sequence of cash flows from the collateral pool in each period for each simulation thread. So we create different paths and we try to generate a sequence of cash flows. The part of the procedure is the same as the cash flow analysis of previous section. The difference is only that the simulation approach, the number of defaults in each period is dictated by the results of the simulations rather than assumed. So here we are assuming, earlier model we assumed, here the results of the simulations are used to compute the credit losses. The securitization capital structure and waterfall allocate the cash flows over time for each simulation thread to the securitization tranches. For each simulation thread, the credit loss, if any, to each liability and the residual cash flow, if any, to the equity tranche can then be computed. Thus, gives us the entire distribution of loss for the bonds and the IRRs for the equity. The distribution can then be used to compute credit statistics such as credit for each tranche. In simple words, they're using simulation technique to generate the cash flows based on the assumed default probabilities and correlation. And they're trying to compute VAR. So VAR we'll be studying in the market risk chapter in detail. Let us go to the next slide. So what are the important points to remember from the exam point of view is default intensity can be time varying. And it can be used using a distribution. So default intensity can be time varying. From each period, it can vary and it can be estimated using a sort distribution, which you will see in coming classes in detail. The correlation between loans are critical in the performance of the pool. So default intensity and the correlation are important in estimation in estimation of credit losses and credit war for securitization. Then we can use Copplers, but Copplers can be used to simulate the timings of the defaults. When it will default, you can see the Copplers. Copplers will be covered under the market risk. When you go into the market risk section, we will be covering about Copplers. If you have studied, you will understand. So simulations allow computation of VAR for each tranche, while Copplers are used to simulate the timing of the defaults, in which period it happens. So these 4 points you have to remember. Default intensity can be time varying and estimated using hazard distribution. The correlation between loans are critical in the performance of the pool. Copplers are used to simulate the timings of the defaults, whereas simulations allow computation of VAR for each tranche. So the takeaway which you should remember. So now let us go to the next slide. You have to study the interactions between default probability versus default correlation. This is very important from the exam point of view, because GARP often tests this in the FRM level 2 exams. To be brief, you have to always remember that increase in default probability decreases all tranche unconditionally. So it's logical, isn't it? Increase in default probability decreases the value of all tranche unconditionally. And increase in correlation will affect each tranche differently. So the increase in correlation impact will affect each tranche differently. We are going to see why it is so in the coming slides. Finally, increasing default correlation will increase the likelihood of extreme portfolio behavior. This we can logically connect. See this case of subprime crisis, what happened when all the assets were like default correlation increased, which the model failed to predict. The models used by the risk management department failed to predict the extreme behavior in the correlation. They assumed a constant correlation, but when the market correlation increased, the VAR they computed were far lesser than what actually it was. And finally, it led to the subprime crisis. So, increasing default correlation will increase the likelihood of extreme portfolio behavior. These are the 3 points which we have to remember. Increase in default probability decreases all tranche unconditionally. Increase in correlation will affect each tranche. So, it has a different impact on senior tranche, different impact on mezzanine tranche, different impact on equity tranche, depending on the character of the tranches and also the default probability. So this is a complex topic which we have to go deep and understand, and practice will be required here. Finally, increasing default correlation will increase the likelihood of extreme portfolio behavior. So if you're asked to explain how the default probabilities and different correlation affect the credit risk in a securitization, the most important point we have to remember here is the effect on the mezzanine bond. It is more complicated in the case of mezzanine bond only. Other things are straightforward, we can logically make out. But in the case of mezzanine bond, a focused mind application is required to understand and remember, because many times we get misdirected and we may choose the wrong answer, because we have to remember this point is the most important point tested by GARP. At low default rates, an increase in correlation increases losses in the mezzanine line bond, but decreases losses at high default rates. See, the mezzanine bond behaves more like a senior bond at low default rates, when it is unlikely that losses will approach its attachment point, and behaves more like the equity tranche when the default rates are high and the breach of the attachment point appears likelier. So this phrase, when you read the book, it appears to be confusing, but we have to go through this trouble to remember and understand this concept. So increase in correlation increases losses on the mezzanine bond, understood, but decreases losses for high defaulted rates. So let us see in detail, let us go into the granular details and see each parts so that we'll have a better understanding of this phrase. So let us take a situation whereby we are increasing the default probability holding correlation constant. So let us hold the correlation constant and see what will be the impact of increasing default probability in various tranches on the mean value as well as the credit VaR. And logically try to connect and understand. So when a question is asked to test our conceptual understanding, we should be able to answer correctly. For many sample questions, we can try and answer. Let us see one by one the case of mean value. What happens in the case of mean value when the default probability is increased holding the correlation constant? So it is uniform for all the case of mean value, it is, the impact will be uniform. For equity tranche, when the default probability is increased, the mean value will come down. Mezzanine tranche, when the default probability is increased, it will come down. For senior tranche also, the mean value will come down because increasing default probability affects all tranches. So equity tranches will have the risk of completely getting wiped off. Mezzanine tranche will have the risk of once the equity gets wiped off, the probability of affecting it will increase, so the value will come down. So when the probability of equity and mezzanine tranche impact increases, naturally the senior tranche comfort level also will come down. So all the three values will come down. So no confusion in this area. But here, when you come into credit VaR, what happens? In the case of equity tranche, when you increase the default probability holding the correlation constant, the credit VaR comes down. But in the case of senior tranche, it goes up. Why? Just so in the case of equity tranche, the credit VaR comes down when you are increasing the default probability, because since the mean value is coming down, the losses also will come down, so credit VaR also comes down. But in the senior tranche, mean value comes down holding the correlation constant, credit VaR goes up. Why? Because the senior tranche risks has increased now. Because of the increasing default probability, now the probability of it affecting the senior tranche is more now. So the credit VaR has gone up for senior tranche. Hope you understood. Now the most complex part of this table comes to the mezzanine tranche. So in the case of mezzanine tranche, if you are increasing the default probability holding correlation constant, the reaction of credit VaR is mixed. So it goes up and down in certain circumstances. In what circumstances? It goes up at low correlation level and then down at higher correlation levels. Why? Any doubt is there, you can ask me, because it's a very important concept. So why the credit VaR is going up at lower correlation level? So here you are assumed that holding correlation is constant, because correlation may be at lower levels or higher levels. So in case the assumed correlation is at low correlation levels, the credit bar goes up. Because the low correlation implies that simultaneous defaults are most unlikely. First it goes up, then when the correlation increases, the credit bar comes down. Because higher the correlation between higher the correlation across tranches, joint defaults are mostly unlikely. So at higher correlation, it behaves like equity tranche. So it comes down. At lower correlation, it behaves like senior tranche. So it goes up. Why? Because the correlation is high. There is every possibility that equity tranche may not suffer big losses. So because it is highly correlated with senior tranche, which is safe. So the investor will predict that equity tranche is more safe and the credit bar value at risk will come down and vice versa. So if you go through this topic slowly, you'll be able to understand, and you have to remember where it behaves. At higher correlation, it behaves like equity tranche. At lower correlation level, it behaves like senior tranche. These are the concepts that we have to understand. Second scenario, I am increasing the correlation now, holding default probability constant. Let the default probability be constant. I am going to increase the correlation. Now I am going to see what is going to happen to my mean value, credit bar. First, let me see the credit bar here. It is very simple and it is logical also, isn't it? When you increase the correlation, the risk increases across tranches because all tranches can move in simultaneous direction and the risk of joint defaults are more. Defaults are correlated and we can predict extreme behavior. So it is reflected in the value at risk. All the VAR goes up. Equity tranche goes up, mezzanine tranche goes up, and senior tranche also goes up. So it is a straightforward for estimating the impact on credit bar. Increasing correlation increases the credit bar, holding default probability constant. So one, again, in the case of mean value, there comes the problem. When I increase the correlation, my equity tranche value goes up, while senior tranche value goes down. So you'll be able to make out the reason. Will you be able to make out the reason? I'm giving a few minutes for you to think over why it goes up. When you increase the correlation, why does equity tranche mean value goes up? And why does senior tranche mean value goes down? As I explained earlier, when you are increasing the correlation, the default of equity tranche is coming down because it is comparing itself with the senior tranche. So the mean value is going up. Whereas in the case of senior tranche, that probability of attachment is more, so the value is coming down. In the case of mezzanine tranche, it is more complex. Here we can say it goes down. The mean value goes down at low default rates and up at high default rates. Why mezzanine tranche is going down at low default rates? Because it behaves like a senior tranche. At low default rates, it behaves like senior tranche because it's more safe. Just remember, at low default rates, it assumes the character of the senior tranche. Mezzanine tranche behaves like senior tranche. So the mean value goes down. Whereas in the case of equity tranche, at high default rates, it assumes mezzanine tranche becomes equally risky with equity tranche. High default rates may attack equity and mezzanine almost equally. So it behaves like equity and the mean value goes up at high default rates. So let us go to the next slide. So explain how the default probabilities and default correlation affect the credit risk in a securitization. Let us go through the convexity. At low correlation, the equity value is positively convex in default rates. So the impact, again, the convexity comes into place and it is not linear. The impact will not be linear. The equity tranche loses value rapidly as default rate rises from a lower level. But as default rates increase, the responsiveness of the equity value to further increases, the default rate drops off. So we have to understand the convexity of the equity value at low correlations. If you are long the equity tranche, once you have lost most of your investment due to increases in default rates, you lose a bit less from the next increase in default rates. For low correlation, the senior bond tranche has negative convexity in the default rates. Its losses accelerate as defaults rise. The mezzanine tranche again is ambiguous, as I said earlier. It has negative convexity for lower default rates, but positive convex for higher default rates. At high correlations, all the tranches are less convex, that is, they respond more linearly to changes in default rates. So at higher correlations, all tranches are less convex, that is, they respond more nearly linearly to changes in default rates. So convexity disappears when the correlation increases and they respond more linearly to the changes in default rates. Now let us see how the default sensitivities for our tranches are measured. Let us go through the theoretical part. We have studied earlier the increasing probability of default decreases the tranche values. Increasing the probability of default decreases the tranche values. However, this effect is not necessarily linear and also depends on the interaction with default correlation. As I said earlier, the convexity plays an important role here. So while computing default sensitivities for tranches to capture convexity, how we can compute? First of all, we should understand that increasing the probability of default decreases the tranche values. And it should not necessarily be linear and also depends on the interaction with the default correlations. So as going to the earlier slide, the interaction of default correlation, if the correlation increases, it is almost linear. So no convexity will be there. So under normal conditions, to analyze the marginal effects in more details, the definition of DV01 is extended to default probabilities and is called as default 01. So what is default 01 or spread 01 or DV01? What is it? The default probability is nothing, but the default probability will be shocked up and down by the same amount. By convention, 10 basis points. And each tranche will be revalued completely through the VAR simulations. So the formulation for default 01 of each tranche is given below. So here is, you can read the equation. So 1 by 20 mean value by loss based on pi plus adding 10 basis points minus mean value by loss based on pi minus 10 basis points. Let us study the equation. What is, how do you get this 20? 20 is nothing but the average. 10 basis points we are shocking up and down. 10 plus 10, 20. The mean value, this is, you can just take it as a portfolio. Value of the portfolio, when you increase the default probability by 10 basis points, minus value of the portfolio, if the default portfolio is decreased by, if the default probability is decreased by 10 basis points. So this difference shows us about how much will be the effect, what will be the effect, average effect, if the default probability is shocked by 10 basis points. The points we have to remember here that is the default sensitivities are always positive for any default probability correlation combination. This follows from the previous observation that all tranches are negatively affected from increasing default probabilities. Second, the default 0 win will approach 0 as default rates become sufficiently high as the marginal impact of increasing the default rate has minimum effect. So we can see that in the longer term, the default 0 win will approach 0 as default rates become sufficiently high, almost will default as the marginal impact of increasing will be default. So in other words, what he's saying is the convexity will be low and it will be much higher. Convexity will be much higher and the change in the impact will be less. So another important point to remember is there will be more variation in the default sensitivities when the default rate generates losses close to the tranches attachment point. Again, as I explained earlier, the tranches attachment point is for equity, we saw 10%, for mezzanine, we saw 15%. So when the losses are exceeding those levels, there will be more variation in the default sensitivities when it is reaching to this attachment point. So this result is similar to the high gamma, high sensitivity in delta for options at the money. The last point will be an important point to remember. Describe the risk factors that impact structured products. So let us again go through this theoretical area. Apart from the credit portfolio modeling issues discussed before, there are at least three other risks that deserve discussion. So we have three other risks. What are they? Systematic risk, tranche thinness, and loan granularity. So what is systematic risk? Systematic risk is nothing but a joint impact of all tranches. For example, let us say a well-diversified equity portfolio that cannot eliminate systematic risk. We can say we can diversify. Suppose we are having we can buy. I'm holding only one equity security. I'm exposed to specific risk to that security. But when I add more equities to my portfolio, I diversify my specific risk, but I cannot eliminate my systematic risk. Systematic risk is nothing but which is exposed to the general macro factors, which is relevant in the market. That we will study in the detail while we are studying the capital asset pricing model. What is systematic risk, how we compute it. So all those things will come there and we will understand better in those areas. So the same is true for credit portfolios also. Unfortunately, even when the collateral pool is well diversified among lenders. So here, like equity, we can get it diversified among the lenders, terms, layout, and other factors. And high systematic risk expressed in high correlation can still severely damage a portfolio. So as previously discussed, with increases in pairwise correlation, the likelihood of senior tranche write-downs increases as well. So correlation impacts all tranche equally. The likelihood of senior tranche also, it increases the probability of write-downs. The equity and mezzanine tranches are relatively thin. This also manifests the relative closeness of the 95 and 99% credit VaR. The implication is that given the tranche has been breached, the loss is likely very large. So, if you are computing 95 equity and mezzanine tranches VaR at 95 and 99% VaR and comparing it, there won't be much difference, which implies that loss is likely to be very large. Again, the loan granularity references the loan level diversification. For example, in a collateralized MBS pool, the portfolio composition is a few loans, but the loans are of substantial size. The reduction in sample size increases the probability of all tail events in relation to the equal-sized portfolio constructed with more loans or smaller amounts. So if I'm having a 1,000 loan pool, and if I change it to 10,000 loan pool, then I have a good level of loan diversification. And the probability of tail events come down to smaller amounts. So in the case of tranche thinness, the important point to note is if you are computing, for example, if you are take the senior tranche, if I am computing VaR of credit VaR of 95% and 99% for senior tranche, due to various factors, if the difference is coming down over period, then I can say that the senior tranche is more susceptible to systematic risk than before, because the probability of happening high loss is more. So let us go through the theoretical aspect of implied correlation and describe how it can be measured. The implied correlation is a very similar concept to the implied volatility of an equity option. So we normally use Black-Scholes method model, a widely accepted valuation model, and so the observable market price is associated with the unique unobserved volatility. For securitized tranches, the process is closely the same. The mechanical part of the process involves several intermediate steps. First, the observable credit default swaps term structure is used to extract risk-neutral default probabilities and possibly recovery rates. Assuming constant pairwise correlation and market prices for the respective tranches, the default estimates and correlation estimates can be fed into a popular. The output is the risk-neutral implied correlation, base correlation per tranche. The correlation estimates will vary between the tranche and are not likely to be constant, giving rise to correlation skew. So let us see breakthrough and see it more granularly in the next slide, how we can compute the implied correlation, how we can measure it for different tranches. So see here, just a breakdown for easy understanding, or have a conceptual understanding. Normally we take the observable CDS term structure for 5 year, 1 year we'll take the term structure, and from that observable term structure from the market, that is the market prices, exact risk neutral default probability and recovery rates from this data, and assume constant correlation and market prices for the respective tranches. We feed into the coupler, and the output is risk neutral implied correlation per tranche, which is matching with the observable market prices. For example, suppose the observed market price of the equity tranche increases from $3 million to $3.2 million, but the estimates of the risk-neutral probability of default remains the same. See, this is for equity tranche. This is for other tranches. For the case of equity tranche, the computation is different. We use the equity prices. So, for example, in the case of observed market price of the equity tranche decreases from $3 million to $3.2 million, but estimates of the risk neutral probability of default remain the same. it can be inferred that the market estimates of the implied correlation must have increased. See here, the risk neutral default probability remains the same. It can be inferred that the market estimate for the implied correlation has increased. So the market value cannot simply increase from $3 million to $3.2 million unless either of these two factors increases. So if you are keeping this risk neutral default probability same, then we can know that the correlation has increased. The precise value must be extracted from the pricing model, but quantitatively the direction is correct. Increasing correlation always benefits the equity call holders. As you seen in the earlier slides, increasing correlations benefit the equity holders. So now let us identify the motivation for using structured credit products. In the first slide, I have touched briefly what are the motivations. Now let us study in detail. Why securitization need to be created? What are the incentives to the loan originators who sell the underlying loans into the trust in order to create a trust securitization? And what are the motivation of the investors who buy the equity of the bonds? So unless there is a buyer and seller, there cannot be a market. So both should have an incentive, and the originator also should have an incentive. Let us see what are the incentives of each person. Let us see the incentives of the issuers. Issuers provides a mean for maturity matching. He provides term funding for the underlying loans, and this motive has two aspects for funding, whether low cost of funding can be achieved via securitization. So he has a project. The issuers, they want to raise the fund by low costing. So they will see whether the low cost of funding can be achieved via securitization. So whether in the absence of securitization, the loan originator would have to sell the loans into the security market or would be able to retain them on his balance sheet. The securitization exit is attractive for lenders only if the cost of funding via securitization is lower than the next best alternative. So the originator will just weigh his cost of between different alternatives. How to fund his loans if he hold in his balance sheet, and if he securitized, what will be the return for him, and how much more he can borrow from the market. All those factors he has to study, and then he has to take a suitable decisions. And for example, if he says, I am not going to securitization, I will retain the loans in my portfolio, then the loan originator may be able to fund the loans by unsecured borrowing. He has to go to the market and get from the bank unsecured borrowing because he will not have anything to give as a collateral. So he has to go for unsecured borrowing. Normally, banks and financial institutions charge higher rate for unsecured borrowing. The logic being higher risk, pay more. So it becomes costlier than secured borrowing via securitization. Any doubt, you can ask. We'll go to the next slide. The next point is securitization undertaken primarily to capture the spread between the underlying loan interest and the coupon rates of the liabilities, are sometimes called the arbitrage CDOs. While securitization motivated largely for balance sheet relief are termed balance sheet CDOs. However, while the motivations are conceptually distinct, it is hard to distinguish securitization this way. Fees also provide incentive to loan originators and issuers to create securitization. A financial intermediary may earn a high return from originating and possibly servicing loans than from retaining them and earning the loan interest. So securitization are motivated largely for balance sheet relief. Fee also provide incentives to loan originators and issuers to create securitization fee income. A financial intermediary may earn higher returns from originating and possibly servicing loan than from retaining them and earning the loan interest. So here, when an originator decides to securitize, he may get a higher return from originating the form of a fee income. Okay, we have seen the incentives to the originator and issuers. Let us see what are the incentives for the buyers to the investors. Securitization enables capital market investors to participate in diversified loan pools in sectors that would otherwise be the province of banks alone, such as mortgages, credit loans, and auto loans. So, the capital market investors will have a wider choice, and they can choose how to diversify their own portfolio by bringing in mortgage assets, credit card assets, and auto loan assets. Because depending on the economic recovery and economic phase, different sectors play differently. Some sectors perform well during recession time. Some sectors perform well during boom time. So they can strategically adjust the portfolio, and capital market investors will have more options in the case of securitization. They have to only buy a paper from the big pool. Again, the tranching technology provides additional means of risk sharing over and above the diversification. Investors, not issuers, motivate credit tranching beyond the issuer's retained interest. So issuers' needs are met by pooling and securitization. They don't require the tranching. So here, tranching technology enables risk sharing over and above the diversification. So investors, not the issuers, motivate credit tranching beyond the issuers' retained interest. So who motivates the credit tranching is issuers. So issuers are not, investors only motivate the credit tranching beyond the issuers' retained interest. So there are two incentives for the investors. Securitization enables a wide choice of loan pools for the investors, and the tranching technology enables additional means of risk sharing over and above the diversification available for the investors. So what are the motivations for using structured credit products? We have seen why securitization requires due diligence. We have seen the motivations of issuers for doing securitization. We have seen the motivation of investors for securitization. Now, what is the role of due diligence in securitization? Why due diligence is important in securitization? Especially if we see the subprime crisis, the main failure here is the due diligence. In the case of subprime crisis, where everybody thought the product is safe and yielding high returns, the product is rated at AAA, while it is giving higher yields, and normally the search for yield happened, so many investors blindly jumped into the market and bought these papers. Then pension funds, pension funds normally cannot go below AAA rating. So they also, they wanted to keep their pension obligation liabilities, annuities in place. So they also jumped into this fray and bought, because these papers are AAA rated because of the flawed model of the rating agencies. So securitization are useful to investors only if they carry out the due diligence needed to understand the return distribution accurately. So they should return distribution here, they should understand how the return distribution works, what are the risks involved. Here again, some institutional investors, particularly the pension funds, have higher demand for high quality fixed income. Securities that pay even a modest premium over risk-free or high-grade corporate bonds. This phenomenon, often called searching or reaching for yield, arises because the institutional investors deploy large sums of capital while being required to reach particular return target. So again, as I explained, same phenomenon. So pension funds often go for high quality fixed income securities that even pay a modest premium or risk-free high grade corporate bonds. The institutional investors reach for higher yield, deploy large sums of capital while being required to reach a particular return target. So institutional investors have to earn more. So they will be having surplus funds after meeting the business, so because they have to give a better return to the shareholders. They have a return target to keep the share prices in the market up. So they will search for the yield. Securitization is founded to a large extent on institutional demand for senior bonds. In the presence of regulatory safe harbors and imperfect governance mechanism, this can lead to inadequate due diligence of the systematic risk of securitized credit products. So, even in the subprime crisis, the senior bonds were rated AAA, and there were larger extent of institutional demand for these bonds, because of which many financial institutions were trapped. So the importance is that due diligence is required. At the same time, presence of a regulatory safe harbors and governance mechanism, because there should be a regulatory controls over the securitization other areas. Because if the regulatory is a safe harbor and the government's mechanisms are imperfect, this can lead to inadequate due diligence, just blindly jumping in and buying the products and creating systematic risk of the securitized credit products. So we have seen why securitization requires due diligence. Thank you.
This conference will now be recorded.